Sameti te samatho. Calmness itself is samatha. Calmness, peacefulness, tranquility, serenity, that itself is samatha. Friends, today is the third day of our retreat. We all are practicing. You all are practicing samatha, serenity meditation. So tonight we want to understand what samatha is further. Therefore, for this talk, our topic is samatha meditation. We want to practice samatha, we want to practice serenity, serenity meditation, tranquility meditation, because our mind is agitated, our mind is restless, our body is agitated, body is restless. Since agitated, we want to calm. We want to calm our body. We want to calm our mind. This is why we practice samatha meditation, serenity meditation. How our body and mind both are agitated. Our mind is agitated when the body is agitated. Our body is agitated when the mind is agitated. These are interdependently existing. Mind and matter. Mind and matter. This physicality and mentality together, always together, one exists because of the other. So when the mind is agitated, body is agitated. When the body is agitated, mind is agitated. Therefore, we have to calm down both mind and body. In order to practice serenity, calmness meditation, first of all, we have to calm down our body. Body means not only this body. Body means six senses. Not only body. Six senses are to be calmed down. So it is because of five hindrances. All the time, we have five hindrances because of our ignorance. Five hindrances come to be because of ignorance. Ignorance come to be because of five hindrances. So what are the five hindrances? Sense desire, ill will, laziness and sleepiness, restlessness and worry, then doubt. These are called five hindrances which hinder our journey to attain enlightenment, which hinder the way that we come to peace. So these five are to be understood. Whenever we practice serenity meditation, calmness meditation, samatha meditation, we have to understand these five and we have to subdue these five things, these five hindrances. Buddha once said, these are like corruption in gold. In gold, when there are some sort of gross, corruption, gold is not malleable, workable. Gold is to be purified. Then only you can say it is 22 carat or whatever the carat. 24 carat. Good one. What are the good ones? 24 carat. Through which you can make earrings, necklace and all the things. Otherwise you can't do. The Buddha said, there are five types of corruption in gold. What are the five? In gold you find iron, copper, tin, lead, silver. just like that. Our mind has five kind of corruption. Those are the five hindrances. Sense desire. We always try to gratify our senses, not only please our senses, but to gratify our senses. That is what is called sense desire. We have desire to please these senses, but we cannot please these senses, six senses. Unsatiate. Then we have ill will. Our will is ill. Ill will. Always ill will. Then mind is corrupt. Then laziness and sleepiness. Again, mind is corrupt. Then restlessness and worry. When we have restlessness, we are worried. Again, corrupt mind and doubt. We are doubt of many things. We are doubt of Buddha. We are doubt of Dhamma. We are doubt of the Sangha. And we have doubt on our own things, like our previous lives, our pre-existence. We doubt about our pre-existence, or doubt about re-existence, or doubt about this world, whether this world even in this world, we have doubts. As long as we have doubt, we cannot calm our mind. We have to subdue these five hindrances. Once the Buddha gave a simile of five balls to understand these five hindrances. Suppose there are five balls of water. In those days, people, they had no mirrors to see their face. They used a bowl full of water, clean water, to see the face. Whenever there is anything wrong, on face, they use that bowl of water. So the Buddha said, suppose there is a bowl full of water which is colored. When the water is colored, you can't see your face. Just like that, when the mind is corrupt with sense desire, it's like colored water. You can't see things as they are. That is the first bowl of water. Then the second one, the Buddha said, suppose there is another bowl full of water which is boiling. When the water is boiling, again you can't see your reflection. You can't see your face. Just like that. When the mind is agitated, when the mind is with ill will, you can't understand things as they are. You can't calm down your mind. Then the third one, the bowl which is full of water but with moss, little things with moss. With moss, you can't see your face. Just like that, when you have sleepiness and laziness, just like that. The mind is agitated, mind is corrupt. Then the next one, the Buddha said, there is another bowl full of water which is with ripples. When there are ripples on water, you can't see your face. Just like that, the mind, when it is agitated, restless, you can't understand things as they are. You can't calm down your mind. Then the Buddha said, suppose there is another bowl full of water which is with dirty, muddy things, even muddy, through which you can't see your face. Just like that, the mind, when the mind is corrupt with these five hindrances, we cannot see things properly. Therefore, Buddha said, calm down your mind. In order to calm down your mind, try to subdue these hindrances first. Friends, hindrances cannot be calmed down until we calm down, until we restrain ourselves from three modes of conduct. Because these five hindrances are fed by three modes of conduct. There are three modes of conduct. We act in three ways: bodily conduct, verbal conduct, and mental conduct. You see, these are interconnected, interlinked. So these three are to be understood: bodily conduct, verbal conduct, and mental conduct. As long as we are engaged in this conduct, of course wrong conduct, there are right conduct, good conduct as well. We have to be very careful with wrong conduct. Three modes of wrong conduct. What are the three modes of wrong conduct? Bodily conduct, there are three things we have to refrain from. Refrain from killing, refrain from stealing, and refrain from sexual misconduct. These three are called bodily conduct, wrong bodily conduct. If we are engaged in this conduct, our mind is agitated, mind is disturbed, mind is restless, mind is stressful, as long as we are engaged in these things. Therefore, the Buddha's instruction is restrain, control, refrain from these things. Then the verbal conduct: false speech, malicious speech, harsh speech, and frivolous talk. These are the four things which are called wrong conduct, verbal conduct. We have to refrain from this. Then mental conduct. There are three mental conduct: covetousness, ill will, and wrong view. Covetousness, ill will, and wrong view. These three are called mental conduct. So altogether, there are 10. These 10 are called unwholesome conduct. Unwholesome, akusala, akusala, ekusala, akusala. Against kusala, these are akusala. One has to refrain from akusala first. Then only one can subdue these five hindrances. Then how this akusala comes to be? This also comes to be because of some reasons. What is the reason? Buddha pointed out, the reason is not restraining your senses. Restrain your senses, six senses: eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, and mind. For this purpose also there is a cause. What is the cause? The cause is unmindfulness and not clearly understanding. Like that, Buddha pointed out the cause, different causes for these things. So we have to understand to calm down ourselves, to come to the state of calmness. First of all, we have to calm down ourselves. Calm down ourselves means there is no self inside to calm down. But we have six senses. These six senses are to be calmed down. These six senses are to be controlled. Then we can control this 10 unwholesome deeds. Three modes of conduct, in other words. Then we can calm down, subdue five hindrances. As we sit for meditation, we can calm down five hindrances. These five hindrances are connected, dependent on ignorance. When there is ignorance, what happens? Buddha said, dependent on ignorance, volitional formations come to be. Then, dependent on volitional formations, consciousness come to be. Dependent on consciousness, mind and matter come to be. Depend on mind and matter, six senses come to be. Dependent on six senses, contact come to be. Dependent on contact, feeling comes to be. Dependent on feeling, craving comes to be. Dependent on craving, attachment comes to be. Dependent on attachment, existence comes to be. Dependent on existence, birth comes to be. Dependent on birth, decay, death, sorrow, lamentation, pain, grief, and whole mass of dukkha, unsatisfactory, suffering come to be. It is because of wrong conduct. This is why we have to refrain from wrong conduct. So the Buddha very clearly said this course. And if we practice, if we develop our mind, if we try to develop concentration, develop serenity, calmness, then we can understand our own problem. It is now clear, in order to refrain from conduct, wrong conduct, we have to calm down our senses. In the Dhammapada, the Buddha said, Chakkuna sangvaro sadhu. Chakku is eye. Sadhu means good. Chakkuna sangvaro sadhu. It is good that you restrain your eyes. Chakkuna sangvaro sadhu. Restrain your eyes. Control your eyes. It is good. Sadhu sotena sangvaro. It is good that you restrain your ears. Ghanena sangvaro sadhu. It is good that you restrain your nose. Sadhu jivhaya sangvaro. It is good that you control, restrain your tongue. Sadhu jivhaya sangvaro. Kayena sangvaro sadhu. It is good that you restrain your body. Kaya, body. Sadhu vachaya sangvaro. It is good that you restrain your word. Sadhu vachaya sangvaro. Manasa sangvaro sadhu. It is good that you restrain your mind. Manasa sangvaro sadhu. Sadhu sabbatta sangvaro. Restraining all over is good. Sabbatta sangvuto bhikkhu. The bhikkhu, the practitioner, who controls, who restrains from all these. Sabba dukkha pamuchyati. He eradicates all dukkha and attains enlightenment. So this is how the Buddha taught us the Dhamma. So friends, this is how we have to understand the importance of practicing this samatha, calmness. When we practice calmness meditation, as you all know, there are 40 different objects for meditation in the Visuddhi Magga. In the Visuddhi Magga, the commentary, they are given 40 different subjects for meditation. Of them all, we as a tradition, as I said the other day, we practice four guardian meditations. The recollection of the qualities of the Buddha. Then the metta, loving friendliness, repulsiveness of body. And then the awareness or mindfulness of death. These are called four guardian meditations. These are basically samatha meditation. For samatha meditation. So when we practice samatha meditation, we always try to give attention to one object and try to stay in one particular area. That is what is called samatha. When we practice samatha, we have to observe only one object. So when we practice this samatha, now as we practice here, we want to practice mindfulness of breathing. Mindfulness of breathing itself is samatha at the beginning. Later on, you can switch to insight. As we practice, as we experience now, according to the Satipatthana Sutta, Buddha said, observe this breath, breathing in, breathing out. When we observe breathing in, breathing out, we calm down ourselves, calm down our mind, calm down our body. And then we can understand lone breath in, lone breath out. Then we can understand short breath in, short breath out. Then the Buddha said, understand the whole breath body, all breath body, where you can come to the to understand calmness. The whole breath body, you are observing from the beginning to the end, whole breath body. You are sensitive, Buddha said, be sensitive of it. So you are sensitive to understand that. Sabba kaya pati sangvedi, sensitive, be sensitive of this whole breath. That's the meaning. Then you can understand calm in the breath. That calming of breath is the calming of body. Breath itself is a body. So we have two bodies, this body and breath body. We calm down both. That is calmness meditation. When you come to this calmness, you are coming to a certain important point, a crossroad, where you can switch to either samatha meditation or vipassana meditation. Purely samatha or vipassana. If you want to practice samatha, this is where you to understand, you to practice jhana. When we practice jhana, let's understand how to practice jhana, how to understand jhana. What are the qualities, what are the factors of jhana like that? Let's take a few minutes for this. When practice jhana, jhana means you burn. You burn what? Burn your defilement. Burn the five hindrances first. So as I said earlier, we have to calm down ourselves. We have to subdue our hindrances in order to come to jhana. The jhana, the explanation of jhana in the discourses, in the sutta is one way, but the jhana, explanation of jhana in the Abhidhamma is another. According to Abhidhamma, there are five different jhanas, which is not in the teaching of the Buddha in the early discourses. Wherever the Buddha talked about jhana, Buddha says like this. Buddha says, Vivicheva kamehi, vivicha akusalehi dhammehi, savitakkang savicharang vivekajang pitisukang patamajjanang upasampajya viharati. Don't be afraid. This Pali, I know that you can't understand. I will explain. What is to be done first? Vivicheva kamehi. Kama is pleasure, sensual pleasure. First of all, we have to refrain from sensual pleasures. What are the sensual pleasures? We have senses. We try to please our senses. So we have to refrain from gratifying our senses. Pleasing our senses, you can't do two together. Meditation and pleasing your senses. If you want to please, try to please your senses, which is endless job. If you want to do that, go ahead. You can do that. No meditation. If you want to meditate, calm down yourself. First, try to restrain your senses, sensual pleasures. That is the first thing is to be done. So the Buddha said, vivicheva kamehi. Then विविच्च अकुसलेहि धम्मेहि अकुसल ए कुसल रिफ्रेन फ्रॉम अकुसल ऑल्सो व्हाट आर द अकुसल 10 अकुसल विच आई सेड अर्लियर थ्री मोड्स इन अदर वर्ड थ्री मोड्स ऑफ कंडक्ट रॉन्ग कंडक्ट दोस आर कॉल्ड 10 अकुसल ऑल दिस 10 अकुसल वी हैव टू रिफ्रेन फ्रॉम 10 अकुसल सो फर्स्ट वी हैव टू रिस्ट्रेन फ्रॉम वी हैव टू रिस्ट्रेन अवर सेंसेस Then, 10 akusala, refrain from 10 akusala. Vivich akusalehi dammehi. Now, the factors of the first jhana. Vivich akusale, savitakkang, vitakka. Vitakka and sankappa are the same. When we develop vitakka, vitakka are thoughts, your thought. There are sensual thoughts, unwholesome thought, thought to grasp things, thought to do something harm to others, cruelty, violent thoughts. These are thoughts, different thoughts. Kama vitakka, Vyapada vitakka, vihinsa vitakka, three types of vitakka. Kama vitakka, sensual thoughts. When you sit for meditation, you think of sensuality, sensual thoughts. Those are called vitakka. Those are bad thoughts, vitakka, kama vitakka. Then vyapada vitakka, vyapada is ill will. You are sitting cross-legged, nicely erect body, but you are thinking of doing something harm to another person. Ah, he did like this for me. Like that. Thinking. Ill will. Your will is ill. You want to do something wrong. Such thoughts. Ill will thought. Vitakka. Vyapada vitakka. Oh, vihinsa vitakka. Vihinsa is to do something harmful to others. Violent. So those are called unwholesome thought, vitakka. And then there are wholesome thought, sankappa. When we meditate, when we practice jhana, we have to develop sankappa, not vitakka, but sankappa. Those sankappa should be samma sankappa, right thoughts. Because by this time, our mind is refrained from 10 akusala. Of the 10 akusala, the 10th one is refraining from wrong view. Suppose you refrain from wrong view, where you end up? You end up with right view, right understanding. Since you have right understanding, now you come to right thought. So this is the path, Noble Eightfold Path. Now you are on the path. You are practicing the Dhamma with right understanding, clear understanding that wrong view is wrong, wrong things are wrong. This is what is right. Therefore, your thoughts are right. Those are called Samma Sankappa. What are the Samma Sankappa? Renunciation, giving up. Nekkhamma Sankappa. Nekkhamma Sankappa. Nekkhamma is renounce. Renounce. To renounce, not to hoard something, not to grab something, but to give up. Renounce unwholesome thoughts. Renounce worldly matters, worldly things. Renounce. That is called Samma Sankappa. Nekkhamma Sankappa. Then Avyapada Sankappa. Instead, ill will, you are developing metta, loving friendliness. Love and friendliness, samma, these are samma sankappa. So metta, avyapada, no vyapada, avyapada sankappa. Then avihinsa sankappa, non-violence. These are the good thoughts, right view, right thoughts of course, right thoughts. So you have samma sankappa. The Buddha said, sa vitakkam. Means that savitakkan means good thoughts here. You develop good thoughts. Savicharang. Vichara is doing it again and again. developing it again and again, develop your good thoughts again and again. Savitakkang, savicharang. Then viveka jang, viveka, you have viveka. Since you are going to practice, since you are practicing, you have viveka. There are three types of viveka. Kaya viveka, chitta viveka and upadhi viveka. Kaya viveka, what is kaya? It's body. Kaya viveka, viveka means detachment, interval, detach. You have detachment, detachment of the body. When you detach from the society, from your family for a few minutes even, you are detached. Your body is detached, that is called viveka, bodily detachment. So you detach, you go somewhere to practice, where you have bodily detachment. Then chitta viveka, mental detachment. Mental detachment is now when you practice meditation, you are detached from other things, other attachment. You are detached, mentally you are detached. That is detachment. Then the third one is called upadhi viveka. Upadhi is the five aggregates. If you attain enlightenment, you detach from bodily attachment. So these are the three types of detachment. So the Buddha said, viviccheva kamehi viviccha akusalehi dhammehi savitakkang savicharang viveka jang. Since you have detachment, through which arises what? Piti sukhang. You have piti because you are detached, you feel that rapture. There you feel rapture. Piti. Then happiness, sukha. Piti, sukhang. With these factors, you come to the first jhana. Patama jhanang upasampajya viharati. You dwell in the first jhana. That is how we can come to first jhana. According to other explanations, this first jhana, you see there is another factor that is called one-pointedness of mind. Ekaggata, which is not in the suttas. Ekaggata. So now that is how we have to practice, develop mind so that we can come to the state of first jhana. Then the second jhana, when you go to the second jhana, vitakka vicharanam vupasama. Vitakka vichara, both vupasama. They, you have calmed, cut down, of course. Vitakka and vichara. No more vitakka and vichara. Because you don't want to think again and again, examine it again and again, because you have come to the state. That state, therefore, you don't need to do that again and again. Where your mind is fixed. Vitakka vicharanam vupasama. Ajjattam sampasadanam. Internally, you have pleasant mind. You have pleasant state of mind. Your mind is calm. Your body is calm. Ajjattam sampasadana. Chetaso ekodi bhavam. Your mind is now collectedness. It is called collectedness of mind. Unification of mind. With the unification of mind. Ajjattam sampasadhanam chetaso ekodibhavam. Avitakkam avicharam samadhijam pitisukam. Now earlier, what happens was that as you have detachment, there arose rapture and happiness. Now not only detachment, you have samadhi. Samadhijam, out of samadhi that arise. What? Samadhi jang, piti sukham. Both piti and sukha, rapture and happiness arose from your samadhi when you go to the second jhana. Samadhi jang, piti sukham, dutiya jhana upasampajya viharati. You come to the second jhana. When you come to the third jhana, pitiya cha viraga. No piti, no rapture. When you come to the third jhana, even no rapture. Pitya cha viraga. Upekkha ko cha viharati. Your mind is with equanimity, equanimous mind. Your mind is called equanimous mind. Upekkha ko cha viharati. Satto cha sampajano cha. You see, there are two factors here. The third jhana, which is lacking in many religions, many practitioners who did in even before the Buddha, they had no this part. What are the parts? Sati and sampajanya. Sati sampajanya was not there. That is why their jhana was called wrong jhana. Wrong jhana. So when you practice this according to the teaching of the Buddha, Buddha said, when you come to the third jhana, there is the mind, equanimous mind, together with mindfulness and clear comprehension. Sato cha sampajano cha. Sukhan cha kayena patti sangvedeti. You feel happiness. Patisang vedeti, yantang arya achikkanti. That is what the noble ones say. Arya achikkanti, upekkako satima sukavihareti. Equanimously, the mindful one dwells happily. They say, this is the third jhana. So then when you come to the fourth jhana, Sukhasya cha pahana, dukkhasya cha pahana. You give up, you abandon both sukha and dukkha. No happiness, no sorrow. No sorrow, no happiness. Both abandon. Sukhasya cha pahana, dukkhasya cha pahana. Pubbeva, somanasya domanasyanang attangama. You have both, you have no both, whether pleasure or pain. Without both. Attangama adukkang asukang upekkako sati parisuddhin. When you come to the fourth jhana, your upekkha, your equanimity and conscious and mindfulness, upekkha and sati, equanimity and mindfulness come to the perfection. Well, very well developed. Upekkha and sati, mindfulness. That is why it is called, it is the turning point, the fourth jhana. When you develop the fourth jhana, then only you can practice, develop immaterial jhana. Or you can develop different knowledge, different kinds of knowledge. There are different kinds of knowledge. We'll understand this knowledge little later. So when we practice this first four jhana, these are called material jhana. So when practice develop the fourth one, you have a good mindfulness and equanimity, upekkha and sati, through which you can understand, you can develop more jhana. These are called attainment. Arupa vachara dhyana, immaterial jhana. What are the immaterial jhana? So the first four are called material jhana, worldly jhana. So you develop these first four, these are worldly jhana, material jhana. What are the immaterial jhana? When you practice, develop immaterial jhana, in order to develop the immaterial jhana, first you have to develop the first four material jhana. Then you can go to the first of the four immaterial. What is the first? Where you are observing infinite of space, which is called akasananchayatana. Infinite of akasa, space. Akasananchayatana. Then the next one is vinyananchayatana. Vinyana is consciousness. You observe, you understand that the consciousness is infinite. Vinyanan chayatana. Then the third one, nevas akin chanyayatana, nothingness. nothingness. You are observing nothingness. Those are immaterial, not material. Nothingness. There is no. And then the fourth one is neva sanya na sanyayatana. Neither perception nor non-perception. So those four are called immaterial jhana. Now you see there are eight different jhanas, eight different attainments. Though you practice, develop all these eight, Buddha says, you have not done what I wanted to. These are only for peaceful abiding. Buddha says, this jhana, these are for the peaceful abiding, peaceful living. In the Salleka Sutta of middle length saints, you can read this. So when we practice jhana in this manner, the first four jhana, where it's like a crossroad, where you can develop some kinds of knowledge. What are the knowledge that you can develop? You can develop a knowledge to perform miracles. These are the results of practicing samatha meditation. You can develop your mind to perform miracles, such as going on water without breaking water. You can walk on water. You can go through the air. You can go through walls. Like that, different miracles. That is called iddhivida jnana. Iddhivida, to perform miracle, miraculous power. Then dibba sota jnana. Dibba sota is divine eye, divine ear, sota is ear. You can listen to the sounds of deities, sounds of any sound. Sounds near, sound far, anything. Because of your knowledge. But you to develop this ability. That is the second knowledge that you can gain. Then the third, you can read others' mind. That is another knowledge. Iddivida dibba sota parachitta vijananam. Parachitta means others' mind. You can read others' mind. How others think of you or others. Parachitta vijananam jnana. Then pubbe nivasanusati jnana. Pubbe nivasa is you can develop mind so that you can read, you can understand your own previous lives. That is what the Buddha developed. Buddha gain first as the first knowledge. On that day when he attained enlightenment, the first knowledge that he gained was that. The ability to understand his own previous lives. So that is another knowledge. Pubbe nivasanusati jnana. Then dibba chakku jnana. Dibba chakku means divine eye. Through which you can understand how beings are born to this world, how beings come to this world from other worlds, other realms. There are 31 realms. Other beings come to this world. And beings here, they depart here and are born in other realms. So the Buddha understood how beings come to here, this world, and are born here, and how they depart here and are born somewhere else. So these are five different kinds of knowledge, which are again worldly. Buddha said worldly. Buddhist practice is not for worldly matters, worldly things, but unworldly. Supramundane. Not the mundane things. Supramundane. To go beyond the world. So, these five are called abhinya in Pali. So those are worldly knowledge, different kinds of knowledge. Now the Buddha developed a special knowledge which is unique. Uniqueness, that is the uniqueness in the teaching of the Buddha. The Buddha developed another one which is called completely eradication of defilement, to destroy defilements. That is called Asavakkhaya Jnana. Asava means underlying tendencies. Khaya means break, destroy. To destroy all defilements, he developed the jnana, the knowledge. That is the uniqueness of the teaching of the Buddha. So friends, in such a way, we can develop our mind. When we practice meditation as samatha, we can develop these different kinds of knowledge as well. And the Buddha said, when you develop your mind in this way, when you release your mind, it is called cheto vimukti, chitta vimukti, cheto vimukti. You release your mind through this way, practicing samatha. So samatha meditation, when practiced, we can switch this to insight. Vipassana meditation. If you do not practice vipassana, you don't get the benefit of practicing samatha. Samatha meditation, once the Buddha said there are four kinds of samatha. Samadhi meditation, samatha meditation. Buddha said, Atti bhikkhave samadhi bhavana Ditta Dhamma Sukha Viharaya. Monks, there is one method of serenity meditation which is for the peaceful abiding here. Then the second method, Atti Bhikkhave Samadhi Bhavana Jnana Dassanaya, for the gaining of jnana, knowledge, and dassana. Dassana means vision. Vision of Dhamma, that is the attainment of the first stage, stream enterer, to become a stream enterer. So in order to become a stream enterer, you need samatha. That's the meaning. To live peacefully, happily, you need samatha. To develop your mind, to come to the state of stream entry, you need samatha. That's the meaning. Then the third one, Atti Bhikkhave Samadhi Bhavana Sati Sampajanyaya. In order to develop mindfulness and clear comprehension, you need samatha. That is the third one. To develop mindfulness and clear comprehension, you need samatha. You need to practice samatha. And the fourth one, Atti Bhikkhave Samadhi Bhavana Asavanakkhayaya. Asava means defilement, underlying tendencies. For the destruction of underlying tendencies, there is a meditation, serenity meditation. So for that purpose also, you need to practice samatha. That is the meaning. So in such a way, we have to understand samatha, the importance of samatha. One day, the Buddha said, Samadhiṃ bhikkhave bhāveta samāhito bhikkhu yathā bhūtaṃ pajānāti. Samadhiṃ bhikkhave bhāveta, bhikkhave, monks, develop, practice samādhi. Samadhiṃ bhikkhave bhāveta samāhito bhikkhu yathā bhūtaṃ pajānāti. The bhikkhu, the practitioner who develops samadhi, see things as they are. This is why we have to practice samadhi, samatha. When you practice samatha, samadhi, you can see things as they are, as they really are. Samahito bhikkhu yatha bhutang pajanati. Kincha yatha bhutam pajanati. Buddha questions. kinchayata bhutam pajamati. What can you see as they are? Rupasya samudayancha attagamancha. You can see rupa. Rupa means form. You can see the arising nature and perishing nature of this form. Samudaya, arising. Attagama, perishing, cessation. Arising and cessation of rupa, this form. Samudayancha attagamancha. Rupasya samudayancha attagamancha. Then vedanaya samudayancha attagamancha. You can see as it is the arising nature of vedana, sensation, and the perishing nature, the cessation of vedana, sensation. Because of your samatha, because of the development of your serenity, tranquility, calmness. Vedanaya samudayancha attagamancha. Then sanyaya samudayancha attagamancha. Sanya is perception. You can understand the arising nature and perishing nature of the of perception. Then sankharanam samudayancha attagamancha. Sankhara, formations, volitional formations. You can see the arising nature and perishing nature of volitional formation. And vinyanasya samudayancha attagamancha. You can see the real nature of vinyana, the consciousness, arising nature and perishing nature of consciousness. This is why we have to practice samatha. Then Buddha said, what is the arising nature? Why? How it arises? Buddha said, abhinandati, because of abhinandati, because of delight, you like it, you are delighted your form, you like your form, you are delighted thinking of your form. When you are delighted, what happens? You say, oh, beautiful. Abhivadati, you say it, oh, beautiful. Why? You are delighted. Abhivadati, then ajjosaya tittati, then you are clinging to that. You are living there inside, thinking that, oh, it's beautiful, it's mine. With that, you grasp your body, your form. Ajjosaya tittati. This is how we cling to. With that, we cling to this. When we cling to this, it comes to exist. With that, birth exists, decay, death, sorrow, lamentation, all these come to be. Then the feelings, perception, volitional formation and consciousness, they all come to be because of delight. We are delighted of this. We want this. We are happy. We try to be pleased with all these five aggregates, thinking that this is mine, this me, this is myself, this is permanent. Instead of impermanent, we see this is permanent because of our delusion, illusion, ignorance. So we are delighted. Then it arises. What is the cessation? If we do not delight, if you do not grasp it, if you do not cling to this, that is the cessation. In such a way, the Buddha explained the importance of practicing samatha. The Buddha said, samadhiṃ bhikkhave bhāveta. Develop, cultivate samadhi. In order to understand samadhi, I will give you a simile. Suppose there is a village in which people, very innocent, very humble, simple people are living. They all are farmers. At the village, there is a huge cliff of mountain, It's a huge mountain. They have never seen the end of the mountain. They live, simply they live there in that village. They never know what's there, the other side of the mountain. They never know. One day, while they were working in the field, paddy field, one person found a plate, a gold plate, in which they are inscribed some word in, explaining what is there, the other side of the mountain. So he got this and he showed this to others, and they all got together, they discussed now what is to be done. They all want to go to the other side. Having understood the beauty of the other side, they all want to go to the other side. But they can't climb. It's such a huge high mountain. They never know the end of it. They can't go to the other side. What is to be done? They have to dig a tunnel. So now they got together to dig the tunnel. They discuss what is to be done to dig a tunnel. What is to be done is you to clean some clean a path to go there, and you to start to dig the tunnel. But these people, they got together and they discussed to clean all over the area first. Clean the all over the area, and then one day they might start to dig the tunnel. So practicing samatha is like that. If you simply practice samatha, just you clean the area. You don't touch, you don't go to the real place. You never go there to dig the tunnel. Digging tunnel is the important thing, not to clean all over the area. So like that, those who are practicing only samatha, they can try to clean all over the place. Not enough. You should go to the real place and start to dig. So that is how we have to understand practicing samatha. I will compare this, I will explain this same story tomorrow with vipassana. Then you can understand the difference between samatha and vipassana better. So friends, when practice samatha, according to the teaching of the Buddha, the Noble Eightfold Path, of the Noble Eightfold Path, the eighth one is called samadhi, samma samadhi, right concentration. Samma samadhi, samadhi is one aggregates of the three. You know, the Eightfold Path is divided into three groups: sila, samadhi and panya. So samadhi group consists of three factors: right effort, right mindfulness and right concentration. These three should go together. Without right effort, you cannot go to right mindfulness. Without right effort, you cannot go to right concentration. These three should go together, like three friends. Suppose there are three friends, they want to offer flowers to the Buddha. They go to pluck some flowers, they go to the park, then they see flowers, blossoms at the tips of the branch. So one person want to pluck these flowers, but can't reach there. Another person, now they want to pluck the flowers. So what the other person did, he bent and he offered his back to him to stand on the back and reach the flowers, the blossom. But still, he can't do, he is not steady enough. So what the third person did, he offered his shoulder to hold me and reach. Like that, these three should go together, like three friends. So they plucked flowers and offered the Buddha. Like that, we have to understand these three should go together. That's my point. These three, effort, mindfulness and concentration, these three should go together. In the Mahachattarishaka Sutta, the sutta named Great 40 in the Middle and Sayings, Majjhima Nikaya, the Buddha said, noble right concentration is to be developed. Noble right concentration. That is what is called right concentration. What is right concentration? Right concentration is called right concentration if the concentration is developed, cultivated with the support of the first seven factors of the Noble Eightfold Path. Can you understand? So the eighth factor is the right concentration. In order to develop the right concentration, to be right concentration, one has to practice, one has to understand, one has to get the support of the first seven factors of the path, starting with right understanding, right thoughts, right speech, right action, right? Like that, the seven factors, first seven factors are to be supported for the eighth one. Then only the right, that concentration becomes a right concentration. If one has right concentration, then only one can understand right knowledge. What is right knowledge? The knowledge of the Four Noble Truths. That the realization of the Four Noble Truths. If one has right knowledge, then only one can gain right liberation. That is the liberation the Buddha taught us. When you liberate, nobody else but you yourself know very well it is liberated. You'd never say, I am liberated. Not I am. There is no I to liberate. This is why it is said, it is liberated. What is liberated? Mind is liberated. Your mind is liberated. Not me. Not I. But your mind is liberated. You then say, it is liberated. Vimukta. Vimukta. Mukta is liberated. Vimuktasmin vimuktamiti jnanam hoti. Then he has the knowledge of liberation. Then he get the knowledge that kina jati. Hereafter, no birth for me. Kina jati. Jati, no jati. No birth hereafter. Vushitam brahmacharyam. I led the holy life, brahmacharya. Vushitam brahmacharyam. Katam karaniyam. Done what had to be done. Finished. What had to be done. Finished. Done. Khatam karaniya na parang ittathaya. No, I never come again to this world. That realization is your own realization. With that, you yourself can become one of the enlightened ones in this world, the arahant. Friends, this is the way. This is the path to practice. It's very clear. The teaching of the Buddha is very clear. So let's all understand this wonderful teaching. Let's all practice this teaching so that one day we all can realize real peace, real happiness of Nibbana. May we all realize real peace, real happiness of Nibbana. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.